Did scientists just successfully grow plants in soil from the moon? What became of the man who received the first genetically engineered pig heart? How did scientists make a breakthrough in superconductivity with everyone's favorite wonder material? Join us to find out more. Greetings, Earthlings. Welcome to Science Fictionally True. And happy August. Today, I'll be giving you all a news update. We'll discuss current events about aspects of our society that are moving from science fiction to science fact that occurred within about the past month. In our first story, after years of anticipation, NASA released the first full-color photos from the James Webb Space Telescope, or JWST, on July 12th. And man, the pictures are breathtaking. The $10 billion space telescope will allow us to look further back to the origins of the universe. It can observe light from about 13.5 billion years ago, when the first stars and galaxies formed. I think the best way to showcase JWST's significance is by comparing it to the images taken by the Hubble Space Telescope, JWST's predecessor. Here are side-by-side images of the galaxy cluster SMACS-0723, the Carina Nebula, the Southern Ring Nebula, and Stefan's Quartet. These images were prepared by the website WebCompare. A link to it is given in the video description below. The JWST can also provide a better understanding of exoplanets, or planets outside our solar system. WASP-96b is a hot gaseous planet located about 1,150 light years from Earth. The JWST collected data on the planet's atmosphere composition, which revealed the presence of water vapor. To be clear, no one is saying that there are aliens or even microbial life on WASP-96b. However, the detection of water vapor at least indicates that life is possible. Astronomers hope to continue using the JWST to find out more about rocky, Earth-like planets that are potentially suitable for organic life. I can't wait for future generations to send probes or even conduct manned space missions to those planets. And speaking of advancements in space exploration, for the first time in history, scientists have succeeded in growing plants in nutrient-poor lunar soil. The research was conducted because it's critical to NASA's long-term goals of the human exploration of space. NASA wants to see if resources on the moon can be used to develop food sources for astronauts living and working in space. In the early days of the space age, Apollo astronauts brought material from the lunar surface, also known as regolith, back to Earth where it could be studied. Recently, scientists at the University of Florida then made a breakthrough with the samples. In their experiment, they tried to grow the plant Arabidopsis thaliana, a relative of mustard greens and vegetables like broccoli and cauliflower. Arabidopsis thaliana is one of the most scientifically studied plants in the world because they're small and easy to grow. The scientists chose this plant for these very reasons. The team used regolith from the Apollo 11, 12, and 17 missions, allotting only 1 gram of regolith to grow each plant. They also used a soil made with volcanic ash as a control group. So what happened? Well, 2 days after the experiment began, all the plants began to sprout, regardless of the experimental group. However, after the 6th day, the plants in the lunar regolith weren't as healthy as the control group. Furthermore, the plants in Apollo 11 regolith weren't as healthy as the plants in Apollo 12 and 17 regolith. And on the 20th day, the team harvested the plants and studied each plant's RNA because RNA can show patterns of gene expression. The RNA analysis revealed the plants in the regolith grew under stress. The results are similar to how Arabidopsis thaliana grew under other harsh conditions, such as soils with too much salt or heavy metals. Although the plants didn't grow in lunar regolith as well as they did in the volcanic ash control, the scientists considered their results a success because the plants were able to grow at all. The results also set them up for future research. 1. They want to understand which plant genes are needed to adapt to growing in the regolith. This could pave the way to a solution to reduce stress induced by the lunar regolith. And 2. They also plan to conduct future studies to determine if plants can grow in Martian regolith. These results lay the foundation for growing food outside Earth, getting us one step closer to becoming an interplanetary species. Now for some news that's more down to Earth. The first attempt at pig heart transplantation failed, and a new study recently published sheds light on why. 57-year-old David Bennett had a genetically engineered pig heart transplanted into him. This event marked a big step for xenotransplantation, which is the process of transplanting non-human tissues or organs into human recipients. The heart was engineered using CRISPR, a genetic engineering tool often described as word processing but for DNA. Researchers used CRISPR to knock out pig genes that would provoke the human immune system and inserted other genes to prevent toxic interactions with the human body. The surgery was performed on January 7, 2022 by medical school faculty at the College of Maryland Medical Center. Bennett wasn't eligible for a conventional heart transplant and was in end-stage heart failure. Xenotransplantation was his last resort. Before the xenotransplantation, Bennett was bedridden for 8 weeks, had life-threatening irregular heartbeat, and had to be on a heart-lung bypass machine just to stay alive. A few days after the xenotransplantation, he was taken off the heart-lung bypass machine and was in active rehabilitation for almost 2 months. But unfortunately, Bennett ended up passing away on March 8, 2022 from heart failure. The scientists were originally concerned Bennett's body would reject the genetically engineered pig heart. However, the positive results achieved months after xenotransplantation suggested that the transplant worked successfully. This is very good news for many Americans. Today, about 110,000 Americans are on the wait list for an organ transplant, and 6,000 Americans die each year before getting one. These promising results give hope xenotransplantation could one day alleviate the wait list. Imagine a supply of transplantable organs that can be produced on a made-to-order basis. The autopsy did reveal some suspicious candidates explaining Bennett's death. Firstly, Bennett was given an intravenous immunoglobulin drug twice in the 2 months after the xenotransplantation to prevent rejection and infection of the organ. The drug contained antibodies that, the scientists now believe, may have reacted with the pig heart and unintentionally damaged heart muscle. Secondly, the transplanted pig heart was also found to contain traces of DNA from a latent pig virus called porcine cytomegalovirus, or PCMV. PCMV was first detected using highly sensitive testing several weeks after xenotransplantation, and then later confirmed at the autopsy. However, whether PCMV actually contributed to Bennett's heart failure is still being investigated. Before the surgery, FDA accepted protocols were taken. Donor pigs were raised in a facility designed to prevent PCMV and other potential pathogens. The healthy donor pig used for the xenotransplantation was tested multiple times for pathogens. Then, the donor pig heart was tested before shipment to Maryland and tested again before the actual surgery. But somehow, the pathogen eluded screening. Future clinical trials will likely have even more sophisticated testing methods to ensure that pathogens don't go undetected again. Although Bennett eventually passed away, there's no denying that we've crossed a bridge we can't turn back from. We've taken a step towards making xenotransplantation a clinical reality for patients in need. In other news, scientists have finally discovered the origins of the Black Death. You may remember learning about it in your history class if you grew up in the United States. I remember I do. We studied it to death in my history class, no pun intended. But even though the disease has been so well researched by historians, we've remained pretty ignorant about its origins. That is, until now. Beginning in the mid-1300s, the Black Death, also known as the bubonic plague, swept across Eurasia, killing millions of people. It was particularly devastating in Europe, where it killed an estimated 30 to 50% of Europe's population. The disease was called the Black Death because it left black spots on the bodies of victims. The disease also causes painful lymph nodes, vomiting, delirium, and other severe symptoms. The disease kills quickly. It takes 3 to 5 days for the infection to incubate in people before they become ill. Then it takes another 3 to 5 days before the victim dies, which happened about 80% of the time. Just like COVID in 2020, the Black Death was an emerging disease and triggered a huge pandemic. Except that pandemic lasted for about 500 years. The bubonic plague still exists today, but instances are very rare thanks to modern-day antibiotics. Recent research led scientists to believe that the Black Death began in modern-day northern Kyrgyzstan and spread to Europe via trade routes. Scientists studied the bodies of three women buried in the cemetery of a medieval community near Lake Issyk-Kul. The three gravestones included their years of death, 1338 and 1339, and indicated that they died of pestilence. Their deaths occurred 7 to 8 years before the plague reportedly arrived in Europe. When researchers examined DNA from the plague victims' teeth, they found an ancient strain of Yersinia pestis, the bacterium responsible for the Black Death. A few years ago, scientists used DNA analysis to create a genetic family tree of Yersinia pestis to find out how it evolved. They found out that the bacterium branched into four strains around the time of the Black Death. One of these strains likely caused the Black Death and subsequent plague epidemics in Europe. Researchers believe the strain found in Kyrgyzstan formed the trunk of the genetic family tree, the mother strain, if you will. The Black Death had a great impact on human history, and now scientists finally understand how it came to be. Now, for some less depressing news, scientists have recently discovered a family of superconducting graphene structures. Yes, everyone's favorite wonder material is back at it. For those who don't know, graphene is essentially a single sheet of carbon atoms arranged in a hexagonal lattice. Although it was first theoretically predicted in 1947, it took until 2004 for scientists to experimentally make the material. And this ushered in an era of scientific research. Graphene has extraordinary mechanical, electrical, optical, and thermal properties. For example, graphene is the strongest material ever measured. As one scientist put it, the material is so strong that it would take an elephant balanced on a pencil to break through a sheet of graphene the thickness of saran wrap. These are the reasons why so many refer to it as the wonder material, and scientists have been racing to unlock its many potential applications. It turns out that superconductivity is one of graphene's many cool properties. In 2018, MIT researchers found that when two graphene layers are stacked on top of each other at a very specific magic angle, the twisted two-layer graphene can exhibit robust superconductivity at low temperatures. Superconductivity is a widely sought-after state in which an electric current can flow through the material without electrical resistance. The same group also reported finding a similar superconducting state in twisted three-layer graphene. And now, the same team is at it again, reporting that 4- and 5-layer twisted graphene can also achieve superconductivity. Their latest study examined a 4-layer twisted graphene device and a 5-layer twisted graphene device. The devices were cooled and kept at less than 1 degree Kelvin, that's negative 273 degrees Celsius. The devices were made so that the scientists could pass an electric current through the stacked graphene layers and then measure the response under different conditions. Superconductivity happens because twisted stacked graphene layers have a type of electronic structure known as a flat band. With this electronic structure, electrons have the same energy regardless of their momentum as they move through the material. And at ultra-cold temperatures, the normally frantic electrons slow down together enough to form Cooper pairs, an essential prerequisite for superconductivity. Many different materials were shown to exhibit superconductivity at low temperatures. However, these temperatures are so low that would be impractical for many potential applications. The scientists hoped their findings could serve as a template to develop practical room temperature superconductors. These materials are often considered a holy grail in the field of material science. A practical room temperature superconductor could enable transmitting electricity without power loss, magnetically levitated trains that run without friction, and more practical quantum computers, just to name a few things. So what do you think? Will the breakthroughs made in space research get us one step closer to becoming an interplanetary species? What do you think is the future of xenotransplantation? There was lots of hype about how graphene could revolutionize our world, but most of its applications have been stuck in the lab. Will superconductivity be one of them? Thanks for watching, Earthlings. Please tune in September for our next monthly news update. Thanks, and see you all next time.